And you think, though, like I said earlier, guys calling themselves apostles that's supposed to be back here in the reincarnation, do you think that you, why they not pushing baptism? They don't believe in the baptism, but the apostles back then did.
There's no way that the disciples of Yahweh shot. It's not even possible.
There's no way.
It's not even possible, bro. There's no way. Them guys, see, a lot of them guys, they're going to get mad all they want. You guys got to examine, man. Y'all was them guys that came up against him because he was going back and forth and with them. There's actually two parts, because I remember bringing the other lesson out. We talk about Luke 7, but there's another one where they were arguing about the baptism. I think one of them was like the scribes and Pharisees, and the other one was like the elders and the lawyers or something like that. You know what I'm saying? It was like all four groups and sectors art was against the baptism. I'm like, bro, we can get that from Zachariah. We can get that Zachariah 9, right? 8:9. We're gonna go into the whole, you know?
That's right. This is the book of Zechariah, chapter 8 and verse 9. Thus said Yahweh of hosts, let your hands be strong, that ye that hear in these days these words by the mouth of the prophets, which were in the day that the foundation of the house of Yahweh of hosts was laid.
There was a day that the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. This is a future prophecy now.
Right. That the temple might be built.
Oh my goodness, in those days
when the foundation was laid, when you lay a foundation, you're building a house. You done laid the slab. Can it be redone without tearing it down? To be the temple, so that the temple may be built. We're building a spiritual temple right now.
Yep.
The scriptures tell you that the apostles is the foundation. We're gonna get it, and Yahweh Shai is the cornerstone. So this foundation already, so how somebody can come in this day and age and call themselves an apostle if the foundation is already laid?
But they would have to be, they'd have to be still in that same position.
Right.
Meaning like they would never lose that position because the foundation was already set spiritually. Meaning if someone is, if you have Yahweh Shai, the chief cornerstone, right? You don't gotta he doesn't gotta be reinstituted. His spot is already solidified. So even after he rose from the dead and been sitting for 2,000 years at the right hand of the Father, that spiritual position of him being a chief cornerstone never moved.
Still a chief cornerstone.
And the same thing will happen with the apostles. The apostles themselves will still have to be in that same position as well. So even if the apostles came back, they would still have to be in that position. Meaning they couldn't be ignorant.
Right.
You get what I'm saying? They can't be teaching something different than what was already laid.
Right.
Because all they're doing is just confirming, if they came back, how the house was built. They'd have to confirm it if they came back again. But if a guy like Tahar and them are calling themselves apostles, they have to confirm the exact same things that the apostles laid. It has to be confirmed, solidified. It can't be different than the original foundation.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Meaning, for example, no one can come back and tell you that the cornerstone is not Yahweh Shai and that it's Moses or it's somebody else or that it's David. Nobody can come back and say that because the cornerstone was already solidified.
You got John from the Matthew 16.
You can hold it.
I got that
Matthew 16.
Okay, let's go ahead.
I'll be the corner. All right. Is that how we did it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so we got Matthew chapter 16. We're going to start at verse 15. He said unto him, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Yahweh shall answer the senator, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against thee. Now the rock is referring to the revelation that he is the Son of God.
Right.
Upon that revelation, I'm going to build this thing. That's why we go to Luke chapter 6. He talks about building your house, you're on a rock.
That's right, man.
The rock is him. That's the same rock that's mentioned in, Deuteronomy 32.
Right, that's right.
The song, that's the song of Moses.
Yep, that's it.
In the song of Moses, Deuteronomy 32, the rock is mentioned. In the song of Moses, that rock is this, Yahweh Shai, that he had to build it on. And he became known as a chief cornerstone. Moses told to speak unto the rock when they was in the wilderness. The Most High said, speak unto the rock. That rock was Yahweh Shai.
Yep.
It was a life figure of Yahweh Shai.
That's right, bro.
You know what I'm saying?
That is it.
Yeah,
you got it. You good.
This is Ephesians 4 and chapter 11. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and some teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the working of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Hamashiach. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of Yahweh, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Hamashiach, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried away, carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie and wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Hamashiach, from whom the whole body fits jointly together, the cornerstone, and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increasingly of the body unto the edifying of itself in love.
The body, what it's like to, we're like unto a building and a body.
Right.
And it's got to be fitly joined together, just like when you build a building, when you're building up a building, a tabernacle, you got to fit in a certain way. You know what I mean? The stones got to fit. They got to be a certain cut, length.
Yeah.
But it all gotta fit together. It gotta fit together or it's not gonna work.
Scripture say he made some preachers, some prophets, some evangelists, some teachers, some apostles, and all for what? For edifying.
Edifying means to build. Edification literally means to build.
That's right.
That's what the word edification means, is to build up.
And that's what we're doing. We're building the temple of Yahweh, man.
Right.
That's what we're doing.
We're just continuing on the same process.
And it was started with the prophets and the apostles, man. And then Yahweh Shai is the cornerstone.
Yep. Get that Ephesians 6. Build it right
this
there.
This is Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 20. I'm going to start at 19. Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of Yahweh, and are built upon the foundation
with the saints.
With the saints.
The saints are the other prophets from before.
Right. That's right.
That some of them will be known, or the ones that have already died.
Uh-huh.
Because at this point, you already had believers that died, like Stephen. He's a saint.
Uh-huh.
Other elect men and women were saints.
Part of that house.
So now the new believers in Ephesians are being told you're fellow heirs with them as well.
Yep.
Go ahead.
And of the household of God. Yehoshua HaMashiach himself, the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in Yahweh.
Isn't it crazy? He said the same thing in Ephesians 4, chapters later.
Yep.
Fitly joined together.
Yep.
Fitly joined together. Meaning in unison, one body, one soul, one mind, one spirit.
Verse 22.
One faith.
In whom ye also are builded together for an inhabitation of Yahweh through the Spirit, man.
Yes, because he's going to dwell in them.
That's right, man.
It tells you that the Most High is going to dwell in the temple, in this temple, which is the believers.
That's why the scriptures say that the kingdom of heaven is within you.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
You're already an ambassador of the kingdom on earth as long as you're in the body.
That's right.
And you are doing his will. You're already an ambassador. You're already... See, the Most High looks at things differently. When they talk about illegal citizens and citizenship rights, the Most High already has the citizens of his kingdom already.
Uh-huh.
So if you're already a citizen of his kingdom because you believed in his son and confessed him, and you've had your sins remitted and you're walking in his way and his will, then you're already an heir and a citizen.
That's right.
You're already there.
Already there.
You're damn right. So that means what? That means that God... My past transgressions, not my past, my future transgressions got to be covered too.
Yeah.
Yep, that's right.
You
got to
be covered. If Lord forbid, something happens and you had to confess your sins, yes.
That's right.
And if the Most High, if he knows your sincerity of your heart, then he can forgive you. Apostle John talks about that.
Yep.
That if any man sins, he has an advocate to the Father, Yahusha. Because he had to remind the church when he wrote them letters that if any man sins, he has advocate. Now, the thing about it is people don't understand this. In the body, there's something called trespasses versus offenses too.
Right.
So for example, if you betray your brother, you're out. You know what I'm saying? Like, for example, if your brother sleeps with another man's wife, you go sleep with your brother's wife or rape his daughter or something like that, you're out of there. That's an offense. You put it out, boy. Or you do like you're scared of it. So, because you still got to strive lawfully. Meaning you still got to strive for the masteries, and you still got to strive for the crown lawfully. You can't
right.
In the NBA, you can get kicked out of the league for doing something wrong. They'll let you have trespasses where you might do something, they'll let you back and get suspended, you come back, right? But let's say you do something crazy that jeopardizes the reputation of the league with the reputation of the church, then you're liable to get removed. For example, you got a situation in the league where a dude might have killed somebody. Some of these leagues where you have a situation where somebody might have harmed somebody, like this guy, Ray Caruth, he killed his baby mom.
Yep.
They couldn't bring him back. And he's still young enough to be in the league. He was a wide receiver for the Carolina Panthers. When he got that charge, he was out of there. They couldn't bring him back in the league.
Yep. What, that's
and even if he came out from jail, let's say he was able to get out, he couldn't be back in because they're like, he's bad for the league. Same thing, you could be bad for the church if you do something so egregious where it's like, you know what? You slept with his brother's wife.
Make the gospel look bad.
You can't go to the Lord and be like, forgive me of this, when you done broke a brother's house and y'all supposed to be in the bay. That's why in 1 Corinthians, there was a letter and Paul was writing about a man that slept with his father's wife. Says you should remove the wicked person among you. He's a leaven. That's 1 Corinthians 5.
Yeah.
If any man be an idolater, a covetous, or a fornicator, remove him.
There was a situation with your boy, the Most High. Who is that? Who is this? One of the sons slept with the fathers.
Yeah, these one Ruth.
Yeah, Ruth.
Yeah.
What the Lord done to him, you know what I'm saying?
Well, he removed his, he's the firstborn son.
Right.
He removed his inheritance from him and gave it to Judah.
Right.
Because if he didn't do that, he would be the head tribe.
Right.
The Messiah would have came out of Judah, out of Reuben. The Messiah would have came out of Reuben if he didn't do that. That's why the Most High removed him from having that glory. You see what I'm saying? So Reuben was the firstborn son. When you're the firstborn son, according to the law, you get the inheritance. So because he did that, he slept with his father's concubines, the Most High took away that glory from him and gave it to Judah instead. If he didn't do that, Reuben would, the Messiah would have came out of Reuben, and Reuben would have been the head tribe. So the Most High still can't put judgment on
like when it's concerning the Most High, I don't never like to say woulda, coulda, or shoulda.
No, but that's, I'm just explaining to you the reason why, because remember, the Most High has a, he has a destiny and a reason for why he does things. And the law, when you read the law on the firstborn son is supposed to get the inheritance, even if you have two sons, right? And you had from two different women. And the first son you have is from a woman, your wife that you don't like as much as the second wife. The law tells you, even if you don't like the wife that the first son came out of more than the other son, the inheritance still got to go to that first son. Because Esau was born first. The inheritance was supposed to go to Esau. That's why Isaac was supposed to bless Esau with the blessing that came from Abraham that he received. But the reason why it flipped around is because he sold his firstborn birthright to Jacob for the food, for the pottage. That's the reason why the inheritance of the firstborn son flipped over to Jacob, even though he was born after Esau.
But then again, man, before all that, the prophecy was...
I know, but the Most I had to have it set up with something. Okay, meaning the reason why Esau lost his inheritance, because he had to do something for him to lose it. Same thing with Reuben. Reuben, even though it was always set up that Judah was going to have the inheritance, Reuben had to do something to lose it. You see what I'm saying? Because the Most has to be just in his doings. You see what I'm saying? So you can point to each one as to why, even though they were firstborn sons, why they did not get their respective inheritance.
It's all according to election.
Yeah, and the Most High set up situations, right, allowed a situation to occur for them to lose it that way.
Yep.
Are you following?
I can dig it.
Just like the reason why the Esau is going to be destroyed is because he did, because of his persecution of his brother Jacob. That's the reason why he's going to be wiped away forever. It tells you in Obadiah. Because of the violence against thy brother Jacob, shame shall follow thee, and thou shalt be cut off forever. Meaning, the reason why you cut off forever is because of the violence that you committed against thy brother Jacob. So the Most High has to give a reason why Esau has to be cut off forever. Too far.
Yeah.
And he knew. These elites, they know who the Israelites are. When they were doing what they did in 1492 to the natives, they were writing letters saying they knew that they're Israelites.
They knew.
And they came with whole armies to slaughter.
And you knowing this and come do this to the children of God, gotta be a punishment coming up.
There gotta be. Because they knew more than back. Even the Mormons knew that. Made a whole doctrine to condemn the natives. They said that the natives were supposed to, that there was a war in heaven, there was a war against Satan and his angels, and the natives who were Israelites decided not to fight on the side of the Most High. So the Most High cursed them with dark skin and gave it over to the Mormons. The Latter-day Saints.
That's why they justified destroying them on this side, on this land over here in America.
Yeah.
That's why they justified it, that they was able to be slaughtered over here because of that.
Yep. It's heavy, bro.
It's evil, man.
It's heavy. The Most High is a just God. He has to be, everything he does, there has to be a justification for it. That's what being a just person is.
Yep.
When you're just, you have justifications for your judgment.
Right. Weighed in the balances, man.
Correct.
Look, wait. That's why it got to hell. you're gonna have a kingdom and a hell, man. You're gonna have eternal life and eternal damnation.
Come on, now.
Because he's a just God, man.
Yeah.
He's not gonna just let everybody get in the kingdom. No. He ain't gonna just let all the Israelites get in the kingdom.
That's like everybody getting the championship.
Yeah.
You done lost.
Come on.
What does it look like? You competing for a title, for a championship. And it don't matter if you lose, you still get it. But the winner gets it too. study film, battle through injuries, right?
Right.
Uh-huh. And won a title, but then they're going to tell you the last place team that didn't even do nothing, that was throwing games in Vegas, throwing games so they can make money off their own team.
Right.
Purposely not making shots, purposely turning the ball over so they can make money. They would do all the swindling, and then the most, and then at the end of the game, the commissioner comes, you're champions too.
Come on, give them a trophy.
Come on, man, get out of here.
Trophy too. Don't make no sense.
But that's what these Israelite kids are saying.
We're gonna get that eternal damnation, just like Yahweh Shah said, man.
Yeah.
Some is resurrected for eternal life, and others gonna be resurrected for eternal damnation.
Wait, so Yahweh Shah is gonna have men ruling with him that spit in his face, slandered him all through his ministry.
Sold him out,
sent him over to Esau to get crucified, and then he gonna come back and deliver those same wicked people and have them ruling with him forever, eternal life. Well, you boys must be out of your damn mind.
That's because you're an Israelite.
You Israelite who's about to out to harm, all you guys are wicked and evil.
Just because
you guys are all wicked and evil because y'all have the same spirit as those same men that did that to the apostles and Yahweh Shai, man, and the disciples.
Right.
Y'all them same guys, man.
That's right, man.
That's evil as hell.
Because if the apostles was here today in reincarnation, they would be speaking the same thing Yahweh Shai speaking and doing the same thing that Yahweh Shai did.
Yeah.
Starting with baptism.
Yep.
They wouldn't be speaking against the baptism when the Messiah got baptized.
How evil that is, huh?
When you really think about it, how you gonna speak against baptism when Yahweh Shah got baptized? And all the disciples got baptized.
You know what's crazy, huh? The Most High don't look at time the same way we do. We're but a vapor in time. Up there, they don't look at time the same way. Yahweh Shah rose from the dead 2 days ago in their mind. That just happened. If you telling me in the world, when you was out here in the world, if 2 days ago somebody did you dirty when you was in the world, you don't forget that stuff 2 days ago if you ran up on them again. That's how the Most High, you think it's gonna be fresh in his
mind.
Y'all spit in my face. You slapped me. You slandered me, you lied on me. And now I'm gonna come back and let you sit by me and rule?
That's the revenge that he's talking about coming back and taking up on.
That's what he's talking about.
On his people. He's coming back to take revenge on the non-believers of his people.
That's part of his vengeance.
Yeah.
Those of my enemies that I should not reign over them, bring them hither and what?
Slay them.
Luke 19:27, yeah.
Slay them before me.
Yeah.
He gonna do them dirty, man.
Amos 9:2, he said, all the wickedness of his people gonna fall like the
sword,
man.
Come
that's
on,
right,
man.
Zechariah.
He's gonna embarrass those people.
That's Israel, man, getting slaughtered, man.
Bro, that's not a way to go out. You don't wanna see Yahweh Shah and the elect in his glory, and then you're one of those guys that rejected him, and he gonna bring you in front of a whole nation and have your head lobbed off and tossed into the lake of fire.
Right. That's right, man.
You know what I'm saying? You think, man, y'all ain't coming back to play with people, man? You feel me?
Yep.
When you see, he gonna be out there looking like Thanos on boys, man.
Oh, man.
He gonna be out there like Thanos, like, man, what you talking about, man? I'm right here. You know what I'm saying?
Keep playing,
bro. You come through on some Thanos stuff, man.
Keep playing, man.
When Thanos came through, he took that boy and smashed up Hulk like he was nothing, bro. You know what I'm saying?
Hulk looked like a toy.
You know what I'm saying?
That stuffed animal.
Thanos just come through just breaking shop with everybody. Everybody just deal to die and left and right. That's how it's going to be, man. The slain of the Lord shall be made.
That's Yahweh Shah, man.
He said he came alone. His wild yo blood red on your apparel. He said, I myself, nobody was with me. I killed them myself.
That ain't gonna be just evil blood.
That's what he said, bro.
Hey, that ain't gonna be just evil blood when it's gone.
People think they seen gangsters before in their life, bro. You ain't seen nothing. You see Yahweh Shah when he comes back, bro. You know what I'm saying? That stuff gonna be crazy. That stuff gonna be crazy, bro.
Alone. and of my people there was none with me, for I will tread them in my anger and trample them in my fury, and their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garments, and I will stain all my raiment, for the day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of wreck of my redeem is come.
Man, right, listen, man. Bro, he about to be sliding on the ops. You feel me? He about to be sliding on the ops.
Vengeance is in his heart, boy.
Right. See, this is the Bible that they didn't teach us when we was growing up, man. That's why I didn't get into it, because y'all trying to tell me I got to believe in this weak Jesus Christ, this punk. I'm watching movies of this guy talking all soft.
And soft and sweet.
I'm like, I can't get with this dude, man. You know what I'm saying? That's something that make no sense to me. I'm sitting there like,
ugh. Walking around with a lamb in his arms.
Yeah.
With a little baby goat in his arms.
It is, bro. That's why I like listening to that Alexander Scorby, man. I like listening to them audio Bibles, because he be having that frustration. He talking, woe unto you.
Right.
Then it make you, it shake you up when you hear it, because you're like, damn, we gotta stay on point.
Yep.
He ain't playing. He said he's lobbing heads off. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, it make you be like, yo, man, he ain't playing.
Public.
Yeah, public. Public execution, bro. That's something, see, it's gonna look like a horror movie to the people that's not of the elect. You know what I mean? That's not gonna look like you watching a slaughter movie, you know what I mean? Freaking Freddy Krueger mixed in with Thanos and freaking Apocalypse all at the same time. You know what I'm saying? It's gonna look like a horror movie to you. You'll see blood everywhere, people freaking crying and yelling and, oh no! Hands rolling left and right. You know what I'm saying? Bring them here. You're gonna drag the dude, boom, right before him. The dude gonna be sitting there like, Lord, didn't I do this for mighty works?
Before he finished saying what he gotta say.
Yep.
Out with his head.
He gonna show him who he was in the past too. He gonna show him, you was that guy that spit in my face. You was the guy you was the guy that slapped me. You know what I mean? You was the guy that lied on me. You know what I'm saying? He gonna show them who they were before he kill them. And he casts them into the lake of fire. These guys talking about the lake of fire, not talking about the judgment of the Israelites. Guys, he gonna destroy his people. You guys are evil as hell. The reason why the children of Israel kept on going to captivity, because a lot of our people were wicked as hell, and there were righteous prophets among them.
Man.
When you read about was thrown into jail under Zedekiah.
Yeah.
When Zedekiah was told, the Babylonians are gonna come and take Jerusalem, you better submit yourself. He was telling them, you're wicked, man. He put him in jail, put the prophet in jail, man.
Yep.
Because he didn't want to listen to him. So there was righteous men that had to go into captivity because of wicked Israelites.
Yep, that's right.
They had to go into captivity with them. Listen, bro.
We ain't gonna be in the kingdom with them.
If the Most High was just gonna snap everybody out of it, he would have been done that back then. The reason why he had to allow it to happen is because the Most High has to show us that the whole nation is not of Israel.
Uh-huh.
Not all Israel is of Israel. He had to let you know there is an Israel of God and there's an Israel that's of Satan.
That's right, man.
He had to show you the difference. We had to learn that and see it today. And you see guys like Zakari, they out there doing freaking, you gotta pay for prayers. But you got guys like the artist woman known as Milli Vanilli that will get on us and say we're wicked. But this guy, will you do a lesson and get on Zakari and get on them for doing that? No.
Awesome, man.
Disquieting of good men, man. Forgetful of good terms. These type of guys.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Them type of guys that is no longer part of us. Go ahead, Al.
This is Galatians 4, starting at 29. You say, but as then, he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit.
Come on,
even so it is now.
Come on.
Nevertheless, what says the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heirs with the son of the free woman.
Come on, right, bro. And that's talking about the allegory of that is of Israel.
That's right.
He's using the allegory of Ishmael
and Isaac, but that allegory that Peter, that Paul's talking about is of the Israel that's born of the flesh.
That's right.
And versus the Israel that's born of the spirit, which that's in John 3. Because that which is flesh is the flesh, that's what spirit is spirit. So if you're not born again, and you're in that flesh, you're going to persecute naturally those that are born of the spirit.
That's right.
Naturally.
That's right. That's why they come up against the true gospel. They come up against the baptism.
Yep. And Paul understood this because he was once on the other side, persecuting those that were born of the Spirit when he was Saul. When he was Saul before he had his conversion, he understood that the reason why he was persecuting those that believed because he was in the flesh. And he was persecuting those that were born out of the Spirit because he didn't understand. But it was a natural antagonism that he had towards guys like Stephen, you get what I'm saying, and the apostles and the disciples. He was going across all through the land, bringing them to be judged.
That's right. You children of the flesh, look at the ones born of the Spirit. They look at you, they think you're wicked because you believe in baptism.
They think you're
wicked because you're going off because you believe in baptism, because you believe in eternal damnation.
And because you, and that's because you have a righteous standard, huh? Because a lot of, we had some guys among us, there were certain things that they were doing wrong and we had to get rid of them because it was detrimental to the body. Guys like perpetually lying, dudes trying to freaking get a brother's wife that he's courting, his wife trying to get the brother's wife that he courting, dudes telling you to go be with a woman that was an adulterer, that was put away for adultery, hey, you go, you can talk to her. None. But these same guys think that we're evil.
That's just what the brother just brought out in 1 Corinthians 5. Paul say, put these type of people, men, from among you, man.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But they want to forgive thy brother.
No, y'all can do what y'all want to do and say what y'all want to say. Y'all could be the Adams family.
Right. That's it.
Brothers, do what you want to do. Say what you want to say. Live how you live or live. Play how you want to play. Dance how you want to dance. The Adams family, y'all could be the Adams family elsewhere. You could be cutting it, all that.
That's right.
Oh, we part of the family of Abraham, the household of faith. Y'all be part of the Adams family.
Hey, but this is what I was saying. See, I thought about all that, you know what I'm saying, about, you know what I'm saying, all what y'all say about these brothers, you know what I'm saying, that don't want to consent, you know what I'm saying, to the baptism, you know what I'm saying, and all this shit, you know what I'm saying. And I came up on this scripture, you know what I'm saying, that, you know, they kind of point out these brothers, man, you know what I'm saying. Look, watch this here. It's 1 Timothy 6 and start at 3. You say, if any man teach otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Yahweh, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness. The doctrine that's according to godliness.
Come on.
Right.
He is proud, knowing nothing, but doting about questions and strife of words, whereof comes envy, strife, wailings, evil surmises, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth. Supposing that gain is godliness, from such withdraw yourself.
Come on, bro.
That's right, man. That's right.
Yeah, and that's how some people are. The gain is godliness. You got like these groups, they selling, they merchandising the people. They making, if you want to pray for it, they ask you. If you ask them to pray for it, you got to pay $25.
Right.
Zakari, you got to pay $25 if they want to do it, if you want them to do a prayer for you.
And strife, man.
Yeah. You ain't lying.
Full of strife. Esau, you the goddamn devil.
You want a counsel for your marriage, you got to pay a consulting fee.
You starting. You know what I'm saying? You're looking for interaction whenever you holler across the goddamn road on Esau and call him the devil.